Before the break, we talk about examples of what's happening in Europe, even outside Europe, and our study on changing pedagogical landscape, and what are our recommendations on also observations, what's happening in Europe on blended and online provision. What now I want to talk about is about MOOCs. So MOOCs are not necessarily part of the regular provision, but a little bit outside as a non-formal education. I will do this, and then we can also discuss some issues how to use MOOCs as a safe way to innovate at perhaps at your institution itself. But first, what's a MOOC or what's not a MOOC? Or you can either to MOOC or not to MOOC, but this is about the definition about what's a MOOC and what's not a MOOC. So MOOC stands for Massive Open Online Course. But you can have a lot of discussion, when is a MOOC massive or when is a course massive? When there is more than how many participants? So, of course, you know that MOOCs have 200,000 participants, or even 400,000 participants. So, it's only a MOOC when there are more than 1,000, more than 2,000. So, there's a lot of discussion on this as well. When is it massive? And my proposition was that it depends on the number of native speakers. Because if you have a MOOC in the English language, it's different than in the Czech language. So, if you have 400,000 in the English language, perhaps the record-breaking one is 8,000 in Czech. So, okay. So, one of the definitions of massive was it's more than the Dunbar number of people where there was some evidence on research where people a professor can have interaction with. So that's about 150. So it's more than 150, then it's more than you can handle in a classroom or in a lecture hall, and then it's massive. But the same questions can you ask when it's open? When is the course open? When it's for free? When it's an open license? When it is has no entry requirements? When it is accessible to all? Even disabled? No? So, where is open stops? Online, we already discussed this morning. There's also troubles in defining online. And course, when it is a course? Even if it's only 6 hours of study, is that a course or is it too little? Should it be one ECTS, one credit, or more? Or a lot of discussion on this. So again, we had a discussion about distance education, online education. One of the recommendations in that changing pedagogical landscape study was we need to have a framework, some definitions on this. And to make it more complicated, there are a lot of abbreviations there. So this is only 6 or 7 of them. There are more than 20 kind of abbreviations. So there is regional open online courses. So they are only open to regions, not to the rest of the world. Of TORC, tiny open with restrictions. And small private online courses. What's the difference between an online courses and a SPOC? So you have an online course, but you also have SPOCs. It all gets confused. It's a sign that the world is changing, people are experimenting, and they want to distinguish your own experiment where I'm having a MOOC. Yeah, MOOC is a newspaper, but now I'm not having a MOOC, I have a SPOC, so now it's a SPOC. So there's a lot of news media attention to this kind of initiatives. It generates a lot of publicity. That's also the reason why it's happening, because it's so much in the media. By the way, there is a report also to make the media analysis, the role and the influence of media in innovation, and the other way around. And who is providing the text and the news items to those newspapers? But that's a different topic. That's a whole research area. So the definition of MOOCs, I'm involved in 5 different MOOCs projects in Europe. And I try to contact to other projects who are involved in MOOCs and to come up with a common definition. And this is a definition I will perhaps stress on you, so that it has another document also justifying some criteria. So when we say a course designed for a large number of participants, one of the criteria in this document where you can find online is that it's larger than the number of the Dunbar, more than 150. But MOOCs are also courses that can be accessed by anyone, anywhere, as long as they have an internet connection, are open to everyone without entry qualifications. So you don't have to be completed a high school degree, etc. Anyone can enter, even people from 16 or 15 years old. That does not mean that there is no prior knowledge. It's about entry requirements. And it should be offering a full, complete course experience online for free. So that's what we adopted in many European projects as a definition. And then some people say we don't have a MOOC, we have a SPOC or whatever abbreviations there are. So I won't give off to many definitions. It's about why are there MOOCs and why are learners interested in? You have to know that last year, 45 or 35, I think it was 45 million of enrollments were worldwide on MOOCs. So 45 million of people registered to follow a MOOC. So a lot of people already doing this. But what are the drivers of those learners? And this is perhaps what possible drivers are in a classroom setting. But what about in the learners? So then you have to define what kind of learners are there. And there are different studies. This is one of Ho performed last year. And in this type of learners, then he analyzed a lot of MOOCs, I think mainly from Coursera. And 71% already had a bachelor degree of higher education. More than 50% were younger than 38 years of age. And most of them were male, so only 31% were female. And yesterday we had a conference, Disco at Prague, where someone of Graz University in Austria performed an experiment where she tried to change this type of learners by being more open, more targeting other kind of learners. And surprise, surprise, the same kind of figures came out. So that's also about MOOCs. It's a lot of media attention in higher education journals, Times Higher Education, etc. So therefore it attracts mainly higher education learners who already have a higher education degree. There are experiments with MOOC provision in countries like South Africa or even Colombia, where in collaboration with civil society organizations, indeed the type of learners can be changed. But it depends on how you design the course, but also which stakeholders you collaborate on, in which media it's exposed. So it's a little bit chicken egg problem. The way you design, the way you promote, will initiate this type of learners. So this not mean that MOOCs cannot be for other type of learners. And then there are other studies who say, what kind of learners are there? And you see that there are learners who are willing to complete the whole course. Or they are only other things, some parts of course that are they are doing. They are more observing what's happening. They are disengaging, but we also want who are sampling. By sampling I mean if you have a course about 7 weeks on 7 different topics, they are only interested in topic numbers 3 and 5. So they are interested in that one, and the rest they are not appearing, they are not discussing. And there's another study with all the different kind of learners. No shows, That's very important. If you have enrollment, 100,000, it's typical that 30% will not even show up because it's for free, I don't have time, what the hell, I don't go. Now, there are a lot of no-shows. Then you can say, what's the difference between an observer and a passive participant and an active participant? There are some criteria when it's very active participant and when it is only a passive one who does something very not very often, irregular. There are also studies on reasons why people study with MOOCs. And this is from Edinburgh. You see here on this one the browse to Edinburgh's offering. You see that one of the reasons why Edinburgh is offering MOOCs is to get people interested in their regular offering. And the most things is about learning new things. So just about learning. Important are to try online education, improve career options, and to get a certificate. But that's depending on age, you see, as well. So this was a study in Edinburgh. This is a study, I have to check. Yeah, I think this was from Lausanne. And here you see that more than half of the students like to enjoy learning on a topic that interests me. So because MOOCs are available, there are more than 5,000 MOOCs, you can choose a topic that interests me and your motivation is there on that topic. And 12% is engaged in MOOCs because they like the format on completely online proficient. This study is by the University of Derby. And then most of their MOOC participants are want to learn about the topic related to their job or related to their personal interest. Last week there was a book published by UNESCO and Commonwealth of Learning. It's called Making Sense of MOOCs, and then it's especially targeting policymakers in developing countries. This book is launched last week, but is not still available online. It will be a few days and it will be online. And it's targeting how to use MOOCs in the most global issues. Global issues are access to higher education, quality education to all, empowering of women, etc. So they are more the global issues and the sustainable development goals of UNESCO defined in their documents. In their book and their analysis, they state that MOOCs are still a powerful tool to provide education for all. So despite the type of learners, where it's mainly male, white, well-educated, there are experiments in developing countries that it can be another target group and it can provide quality education for all. MOOCs by therefore need to be part of the opening part of education, and it should use the scalability of online tools. Most importantly, MOOCs should embrace diversity. So therefore, I'm talking to you as well. If you develop MOOCs, support the diversity. You support your own language, your own culture. Don't compete with Harvard and try to do a MOOC in a topic that's already available by Harvard, MIT, or whatever. Try to do it with your own added value and try to target your own target group, embracing diversity. So what's happening now is, for example, Coursera, they try to have automatic translation services, but they are mainly targeting continuous professional education. They're mainly targeting for now white, male, well-educated. And you need to target the diversity as well, especially in regions with small languages. And what I try to do together with UNESCO and Commonwealth of Learning is to have that generic model of MOOCs be re-engineered to a broad spectrum of audiences and approaches and contexts. And that can be done. So it's about scalability. What I talked before the break, blended learning and online learning is maturing, is going to be done, is done. It's done by the major universities. What the main danger is that one said there were only about 10 online universities available in worldwide. They will provide 80% of the mass education. No. You need the context, you need the local case studies, you need your local language and your own culture. And there's an optimum about scalability. You can scale up to the world level, or you can keep it at the professor level. No. MOOCs are about scalability. The online tools are about scalability. You can use the scalability of all online tools to open your broader audience. And the tools can be used in collaboration. So what's happening now in Europe? Every country is making a MOOC platform. We have a platform, FutureLearn, in the UK, who's open to many more. In France, we have FUN. It's a French MOOC platform. In Spain, we have MiraDAX. In Austria, we have iMOOCs. In Italy, we have Edu Open. In Ukraine, yesterday, their platform was called Prometheus. Supporting their own language, supporting their universities. So then the collaboration is done on the national level. And Americans find that very inefficient, because you need to be at the global level. No, you need to be intermediate. It can be even regional. Not national, but regional, depending on how big the country is, etc. And to fully potential the online learning, especially this with MOOCs, you need to have regional strategies. And I already said this morning that we have different levels, the European Commission, national level, higher education level, faculty, etc., the 7 levels there. And you need to develop regional strategies on this one. So what we try to do as an association is to empower those regional initiatives. Not only empower institutions, but also regions. So collaboration cross-institutional. And what I'm trying to do is also at the level of country level, that the European countries are working together. Of course, they have their own platform at the national level, but you can collaborate on that level as well. So again, I recommend you to read this book, download this book, and it will be available end of this week, early next week, and it gives you a whole different picture on MOOCs than what the Americans are doing. And doesn't mean that we have to compete with Americans, we can collaborate, but we have a different perspective, the more social dimension on MOOCs. I want to talk to you also about some analysis of why are higher education institutions involved in MOOCs? So what are the main reasons to do that? You have to know that in the United States, the Babson Group already performed a longitudinal study for 14 or 13 years on online education and distance education. So there is a US-wide survey amongst many institutions on the adoption of online learning. And you see that the grade level tracking online education in the United States, you can download the report as well, that's there. Just for your notification, the PowerPoints I am using will be made available by Lucy for the rest of you. It will be recorded as well, so the PowerPoints are available. The links are clickable, so you can then click on those reports. The AUA, so the European University Association, also made a study on e-learning in 2014 already, 2 years ago, and included also some questions on MOOCs in this. So there are reports on what's happening on e-learning in Europe as well, but not that extensive as in the United States, where we're already done every year for 13 years. What I did in one of the projects where Lucy is also participating, called HOME, we tried to initiate a survey in Europe on MOOC strategies. So not on e-learning, but especially targeting MOOC strategies. This was done in 2014, is repeated in 2015, and will be repeated later this year. So then we have already 3 years in successive survey in Europe on, in this aspect, MOOC strategies. This is another study done by IPTS in Sevilla, the European Research Center on Education. And they made a research on how institutions are dealing with openness. So that report is also available. So looking at, for example, the US survey, there are questions on MOOCs on this available. You see a lot of respondents in the US survey. So they had a self-selected sample addressing more than 4,000 higher education institutions. And more than half of them responded in that questionnaire. But the MOOC questions are only answered by those institutions who are offering MOOCs. So only 14%, that means about 400 institutions responded to the MOOC questions. So this is about scale of respondents. And what you see in this figure is the number of institutions who have a MOOC, is planning a MOOC, has not yet decided to have a MOOC, or has no plans to have a MOOC. And that for 2012, 13, 14, and 15. So for 4 years, about the figure of how many institutions are involved in MOOCs in the United States. And you see that the yellow and the orange, or the blue one, in total stays the same for 4 years. So their conclusion is that MOOCs is not a hype anymore. It's only 40% of the higher education institutions that are involved, and that's not increasing or decreasing. Even if you see this figure at the end, the number of institutions who are planning are indeed having a MOOC platform, but the number of institutions indeed planning is not increasing. So the total is stable, about 14%. So then my main question, what's happening in Europe? Are we doing less, more involved? What's happening in Europe? So then we have now 4 studies on this question. So the AUA did that in 2013. The survey I did in 2014 and in 2015 had it as well. And the IPTS did have the same question. So there are 3 independent studies targeting this. And this is a result in Europe for those 4 different kinds of studies. So the AUA in 2013 said more than 10% of the higher education institutions are involved, and in total 56% is having or planning to have a MOOC. So more than 50% is already stated by the AUA. Compare that to the 14% in the US. Much more involvement. Then in my survey, we tried to repeat that, and it was more than 70% even that was involved. But that sample was very small, so that can be a lot of bias on this. And because there were potential bias, the IPTS study did a lot of post-data correction for those biases. And even after post-data correction for those biases, IPTS came up with more than 40% of higher education institutions in Europe are or are going to be involved in MOOCs. So we repeated the survey this year again. It's again more than 60% is involved in this survey. So if you correct for all the biases and you believe the most research-based institution in the European Commission, more than 40% is involved. You have to know that in Europe we have almost 4,000 higher education institutions, 3,800 somewhat. So if half of them are publishing MOOCs, then the MOOC market is dominated by the European institutions, not by the American. But all the news media, all the business is done in America. So what I now try to do is say, no, it's not the US who is leading, Europe is leading. But we are this 28 countries, we have diversity, etc. So, but collectively, we are more involved than the US. So this is an overview. 3 years of the US, very stable. And 4 different studies in the European Union indicating much more involvement in Europe. So you can have the question, why is that? Why is Europe much more involved? I didn't show the result from the Czech Republic. There, Lucy is preparing a country report on the latest survey. And the number of response was 9 institutions, Lucy? 9, yeah. So that is typical, I think, more representative of what's happening in Czech. And about 66% replied that they are planning to have a MOOC in the near future. So it's not only Western and Northern Europe, or Spain and Greece, but it's also happening in Central and Eastern Europe. So why that difference? Because I'm just doing the research on the difference. Why are those differences there between the US and Europe? And there are some hypotheses, some things that can be done related. So one can be related to the ICTS framework. But how does that? So that's related more to the credits and that we can give credits to MOOCs within some constraints, etc. The hypothesis I'm now working on is that there's a difference between higher education systems. So in continental Europe, most of the higher education institutions are public funded, state funded, and have more or less equal resources compared to the more market-based US model, where there is a mixed private-public funding, and more private even than public. And the US market educational system approach has large differences between the weak and the strong universities. Well, the difference in the Netherlands and even Czech are not that large. Of course, you have the better universities and less, but that every university has the means to develop MOOCs. Looking at the motives, why are institutions involved in MOOCs as kind of online education? I will skip this one. So this is a question about credentials of MOOCs. So that's the same question done in the United States. It's repeated in the European survey. So it's the same, exact the same question addressing more or less the same audience. You see below the US, where more than 60% agrees that credentials for MOOCs will cause confusion in higher education. In Europe, it's 15% or less than 10% who is agreeing to this. And that might be related to the ECTS and the Bologna framework, where we say, okay, if you provide credits, it's very clear that it's are just credits for completion, or even can be an ECTS credit. There's a clear line between them. This is also the same question in the US and in the European survey. And the question is, are you agreeing or not with MOOCs are a sustainable method for offering courses? And you see that in the US, in 2013, it was more than 20, and a decrease in 2014 to less than 16%, agreeing with this. In Europe, both surveys indicate that more of half of the universities say it's, one way or the other, a sustainable method. But you have to know the definition of a MOOC is that the MOOC is provided for free. So how can something be for free and still sustainable? There's a whole area on open business models, like with open software, open software can be sustainable. Open access journals, where the scientific output is for free, can be sustainable or are even already sustainable. MOOCs, who are for free, are seen in Europe as a sustainable way for more than half of the respondents to provide online education for free to all. We can discuss the business models behind that, but that's not in my slides yet. So then we asked, how well are MOOCs meeting your institutional objectives then? So did you define why you are in MOOCs and what's your objective is this? And then only a low respondent said they are meeting some of all of them. Most of them. But a large respondent said they are meeting some of the objectives we had with MOOCs. More than compared to the US, where they say it's too early to tell. Another question, exactly the same as in the US and in Europe. MOOCs are important for institutions to learn about the online pedagogical approach. You see at the bottom line, 2013 US, 2014, there's less interest in the US in the online pedagogical approach on MOOCs. It was more than 40% and it's less than 30% in 2014. In Europe, more than 80% of the respondents said it's an important tool to learn about online pedagogical approach. And that might be also a tool for you university, the University of West Bohemia, or in this region, other universities, to look as a MOOC as a safe, experimental, innovative way for trying other way of online provision. Because it's outside your formal degree, it can be related to your official course of you are offering, and have experiments with different kind of online pedagogical approaches. And that's one of the reasons why European institutions are involved. Again, the same question in the US and in Europe. And the question is, what is the primary objective of your institution to be involved in MOOCs? So by primary objective, they only could select one of the 9 options that were there. And the 9 options here are listed here below. I will not repeat it, but you see that the light blue is most in favor. And light blue is to increase the institution visibility. So it's about media exposure, about the visibility, why you're doing MOOCs. In the US, you see that this one is very important as well. Drive student recruitment. So to get more students to your campus offering. The difference with the European one is the yellow one. The yellow one is to learn about flexible learning opportunities. So why Europe is more involved in MOOCs? Their main driver is to innovate pedagogy, to have experiments with innovative pedagogical approaches in a flexible learning way. And if you look at the target group, is that here? Yeah, that's the dark blue. This dark blue one, this is very small in the US. It's more visible in the Europe. And that's related not to drive student recruitment, but to reach new kind of students. So that doesn't count for all institutions, but you can say MOOCs are a way to innovate the pedagogical approach of your online courses, to learn about flexible learning opportunities, and or to reach new kind of students. Then in the survey I did, I wanted to know more about the relevance of different kind of objectives. So not only the primary objective, but also what kind of objective do you find the most important or not important? And you see here that the financial reasons are not the main objective. It was not in the previous version as well. Is it this one? Yeah, the primary objective. If you look at this one, generate income, hardly any institution says that's the primary objective where we are in MOOCs, is to generate money. No. Not important in the US, not important in Europe. So that was for the primary objective. Then I asked for the relevance of different objectives, and then financial reasons are for some institutions relevant. You see that still about 20% says it's relevant to look at the financial reasons, cost reduction, or even to increase income. But the most relevant objectives are the demands of learners and societies, innovation area, and the reputation and visibility of your institution. So it's not only to learn and to innovate, but also to respond on the demand for learners and the demand of society, and to increase your visibility and reputation of the institution. And the same is confirmed in the latest survey in 2015. The report will be out very soon, this country report as well. Financial reasons are not that most important. Most important are the other three ones. We also asked the respondents about their main target group. And I hope you can read it, what's standing below, but there's not a big difference. Even also surprising for you is that the target group for the MOOCs is not only new students, but also full-time students enrolled at your own university. So they are using MOOCs also in their regular online provision, because they are targeting the full-time students of your own institution. The highest response was on the further education for students, lifelong learning, continuous professional education. But there are not a big difference. I was expecting more difference in this one. And then we asked also, if you have MOOC provision, on what level has MOOCs the most impact? You can say MOOCs are very safe, they are outside the regular provision, but MOOCs need to be developed and need to be involved. So what is the main impact of at your institution? And you see hardly no impact is expected or seen in, that's the blue one, on staff and administration and staff management and in central services. But a high impact is seen in students, both online distance, part-time, not that many on full-time. So is there another conclusion to make? Do I miss something? Most of them says has little impact, so therefore it's very safe to have that kind of innovation. So that's all about MOOCs now. I can talk a lot more about MOOCs, about the business models of MOOCs, and how you can generate a sustainability on this. I did put some flyers on MOOC projects here in front, so I'm involved in 5 different MOOC projects. For me, it's a kind of innovation of online education that is partly safe, but also has large implications, like the unbundling where we talked about, and also the way you can open up your education to a wider audience.